lot of things to cover today because we did get a note back from a recent alum that he does want to come in and speak about a topic we addressed last week. So we'll revert back to it in the second half of this class on daily fantasy. And he's not here to give you advice on your team, so. Me too. I had Keenan Allen on it. It's bad. He is Adam Berger at Dwayne Morris, and he represents FanDuel. And he's one of, I guess, hundreds of lawyers that do, but here in Philly, and it's a great opportunity for us to visit with a recent grad, 2009 or 10, I don't know which one, who has had some experience now, 5 or 6 years, in the industry. And what you'll hear about is obviously how he came to be where he is, how Daily Fantasy came to be one of his projects, and I guess most importantly, how he sort of fell into working in sports law, when that certainly wasn't where he started, which is again a common example I talk about with you guys. Most people aren't like me, where they sort of go from law school into sports, they go into different areas. And they transition into sports through a lot of different ways. In the case of Adam, and in the case of a lot of people, maybe others will bring in this semester, they're working on something else. And I think in Adam's case, I'll let him explain it a lot better than I can, but I think it was gaming in general, right? Gaming meaning casinos or whatever that means. And then got into this fantasy angle. Again, I think from a sports business point of view, it's one of the more interesting topics I've ever come across. The ascension, I guess the word is, of A, fantasy sports, and B, daily fantasy. It has become huge business, and from a sports law business point of view, the way I look at it is an incredible fan engagement tool that sports leagues desperately want to keep alive, that commissioners desperately want to keep alive, but have to, in the name of integrity and the best interest of the sport, keep arm's length, right? Because it's gambling. As we sit here today with our vocabulary, gambling is like, you know, you're either gambling or you're not. It's like being pregnant. You know, there's no kind of in-between. There's no kind of slightly gambling or slightly pregnant. There's only not pregnant or pregnant. And I think that's true in gambling. There's only not gambling or gambling. But what commissioners are trying to do is say, well, there is slightly pregnant, right? Because there's... it's gambling, but it's fun. And this is a constant struggle that I think sports leagues, sports commissioners, sports associations, and frankly, the labor side too, players, have. Because it's not just FanDuel and DraftKings sponsoring teams and leagues. They're sponsoring unions. They're all in with the NFLPA, with the NBAPA, with Major League Baseball Players Association, DraftKings. So this goes on both sides of the aisle. This is both sides of the party table. Again, think about for your own purposes, for your own thoughts, for your own ethics, what you think this is. Because we have a history in sports law of non-tolerance for gambling. But in the past year, we have seen tolerance for whatever this thing is, slightly pregnant. It's out there. And that's why, even though we did discuss it last week, it's worth another hour, because I think getting the practical perspective of an expert in the industry that happens to be a recent alum is going to be really interesting for me and you to hear from Adam Berger. Adam was on one of the panels last year when we hosted symposium panels about this topic, along with counsel for DraftKings, and along with a U.S. attorney, state attorney, about this issue. So it's really complex. Again, no one thought we'd be where we were a year ago. No one knows where we'll be next year on this topic. But we play fantasy. We like it. It's an incredible engagement tool. I just think watching what I see from my own friends, family, people I know, it has got them into sports in a way that they've never been into sports. Is that health? That's another thing. Is this a public health issue? Because as the attorney generals talk about, does this take us into an area we don't want our kids, our young adults, to be in? Or is it fun? It's a really interesting topic. Maybe one as much for sociology as for sports law. Because this obsession with games and winning and competition that we have as a society spills over into some maybe unhealthy behaviors as well. I think we all believe that season-long fantasy where parents and children get together and draft their teams and call them every week, we all kind of agree that's fun. Do we agree the same when it's week-long, when it's every night? How much money do we think is safe? How much money do we think is not safe? How much time? How much investment? All topics. At the end of the day, I'll leave it here, but we'll hear from Adam about what we kind of resolved last week, that this has moved from heavy litigation to heavy legislation. And New York is among many states that have now, at least temporarily, for the foreseeable future, resolved fantasy sports with a bill. And I think Adam's worked on some of that. I don't know nationally, but certainly locally here for Dwayne Morris. Okay, we'll talk about that. In the hour we have before Adam gets here, I really want to get into some more of this commissioner discipline in terms of what's allowed and playing off the real kind of social justice issue that hit us at the start of the semester, playing off this Kaepernick protest that has evolved way beyond Colin Kaepernick, other players, other sports, and different positions, if you will, besides standing, kneeling, sitting, arm in arm. So this thing is resonating. It really has. And the reason it sort of takes us back to these other situations where, for instance, you have offensive comments on the team side. And then the question I ask you to start thinking about as we now discuss these is, what's the issue now? Do we treat this with the same lens that we treat Kaepernick? If it's coming from, again, the other side of the table, the ownership side of the table, the management side of the table. So let's look at a couple situations. First, the former owner of the Cincinnati Reds. Seems like we talk a lot about Cincinnati Reds. Marge Schott. Who's talking about her? Tell me your name again.
Brian.
Go ahead, Brian.
Right, like you said before, Marge Schott was the owner of the Cincinnati Reds in the 80s and in the 90s. Yeah, so during her tenure, she made a lot of offensive and racist remarks toward African Americans, Jewish people, Japanese.
And here are some of them, and these are the ones that I didn't have to edit for being a family show here, and we're on tape. These are some of the nicer ones. Go ahead.
Yeah, so these statements were revealed in a deposition. And Bud Selig, you know, he thought that this was not in the best interest of baseball, especially if they wanted to promote diversity, and this does more so.
So what did he do to her?
So Bud Selig fined her $25,000, suspended her for 1 year, and made her take 10 multicultural training programs.
Okay. So now you're the commissioner, or you put yourself in the shoes of advising the commissioner. You have an owner. We're back to the Finley situation where commissioner disciplining the person, one of the people who works, who he or she works for. Again, this strange relationship between employer and employee. Marge Schott is one of Bud Selig's employers, yet Bud Selig is suspending his employee. I'm sorry, his employer for a year. Listen, we'll get to Donald Sterling. I would have said up until last year, you can't take away a franchise from someone. Now I guess you can, but Bud Selig was not going to take away the Reds, but what he could do was take her away from the Reds. Because she had racist, because she had anti-Semitic, because she had anti-gay remarks, and these were repeated, the commissioner stepped in. And again, think about, is that something you would have done? And tell me the discipline again, a fine of
$25,000,
which is couch cushion money for her. But today, that would be ramped up significantly. This is a while ago. And the year suspension. And what exactly were the terms of the suspension? Could she come anywhere near the team?
It didn't really explain much in the textbook, but I'm pretty sure she didn't stay near the team.
Yeah, she, I think she had to stay away from the facility, Riverfront Stadium, and she had to operate as a, I guess, silent, obviously silent, but non-involved ownership. In other words, the team, for all intents and purposes, from the commissioner's viewpoint, was turned over to her general manager. Everything, when there were league meetings, when there were decisions to be made about the team, it was all done by the management rather than the owner. So in those days, you would have a league meeting and every team would be represented by an owner, one person usually. Her seat would now be taken by whoever she hired. She would be banned from those meetings. She would be banned from operating the team. 1 year. Again, how different is this from Colin Kaepernick? How different is this from a league deciding not to step into this area? Are Marge Schott's constitutional rights being violated? Any thoughts here? What do you think?
So basically, I mean, since it's a free speech, right? Even though this is a private organization, I don't think she could, you know, really, that can't be in her defense. But to be honest, yeah, I think she was in the wrong here.
Well, yes, it is definitely private. She has no right to public protection here. Could she have fought this with a case that we could be reading about? Yeah, but she chose not to. It certainly was a popular decision because she upset so many groups. But here is an example of a commissioner acting in the best interests of baseball by banning a homophobic, racist owner for a year. A year's a steep penalty in sports. So that's a long time. Okay, now we contrast and compare that with, you're also talking about
John Rocker,
who's on the player side saying similar type of things. Go ahead.
Yeah, so during a Sports Illustrated interview, he made racist and offensive remarks, just like shot about African-American teammates and people in New York, especially against foreigners.
Such as this. He talks about riding the 7 train to play the Mets. Imagine having to take the train to the ballpark looking like you're riding through Beirut next to some kid with purple hair or next to some queer with AIDS. And again, as was shot, I'm showing you the PG version. Okay. Player. We just saw an owner. Now we have a player. Bud Selig, same thing. What do you do? Before we get to what he did do, anyone, what do? Let it go? Yeah.
I don't think you can let it go because he's representing the Major League Baseball brand, and you know, those, even those PG comments are not comments that you want to be associated with as a league, as a brand. Obviously you don't want to discriminate any types of people that may or may not be fans. It's just not good for the league.
What do you do?
I think you have to, I personally would certainly fine and suspend them.
Both?
Yes.
Okay, suspend them how long?
Maybe 10 games.
Okay. Which I guess like in football terms, that's one game.
Yeah.
Isn't he a reliever though?
Mm-hmm.
So he'd probably pitch a little more than that.
Should that matter?
No, I'm just saying.
No, I guess should it matter?
Yeah. I mean,
whether he's an everyday player or a relief pitcher, should that matter?
I would say it wouldn't matter.
So you'd give him a longer one based on being a pitcher?
Yeah. It was kind of like I was alluding to like a suspension for getting in the fight earlier this year.
Yeah.
He already got 10 games, but they probably would have given a pitcher, like, well, 10 games, too bad, 22 starts for him, rather than 10 days at that point. But
that's interesting. Anyone else? Anyone let this go? Because you're worried about having to discipline every player who steps out of line with what they say? Anyone take that view, Alex?
I don't take that view. I just think that if you like think about it in a real world perspective, like an employee at a store or something saying like something like this would get disciplined. So I think that to think that athletes should have like a more free speech right than another employee is kind of ridiculous. So I definitely think you should discipline them.
Okay. And what was the discipline?
Suspended for spring training in 28 games into the regular season.
28 games after spring training, and what was it? Went he, as you see there, that was Rocker brought a grievance, or actually the Major League Baseball Players Association brought a grievance on his behalf, and the suspension was reduced to. Anyone know what it was reduced to? I know it was reduced. Because the arbitrator thought that 28 games was too much.
I think it was 14 games.
Okay. So it was cut in half. Yeah, nice job. It was cut in half. Which again, I can't stress this point enough, and this is from my background as being a team front office member. Everything you do has impacts beyond that person you're doing it to, so everything is precedent. So again, think about Bud Selig, think about a commissioner's office, think about being an attorney there and trying to establish some bright line rule. If you have something like this, you really have to think about where you're putting the line down. Because, again, in baseball, you're dealing with 600 players. People are going to step out of line with what they say. I think, as was said, the brand thing is a very good point because now, you know, I think it also matters where. This was done in Sports Illustrated. Huge brand, huge coverage for baseball. And that's something that made a difference to the commissioner's office, obviously. Did he go too hard? Probably. And then an arbitrator cut it in half, but that's where we're going. Again, this continuing theme of commissioner discipline, where it's best for the sport, where it's integrity, where it's people have to feel good about this product. We have to discipline, we have to maintain moral integrity. So we're sort of a role model for all, not as a player, but as a league, as a public trust, if that's a word you can use. Major League Baseball, NFL, NBA, hockey, soccer, I mean, they view themselves as public trusts and have to operate in a certain way. Okay, any other questions about this rocker? Now, anyone know whatever happened to this guy? He's still spouting off, I think.
He's selling, the last like I heard of him, he was selling not-so-PC t-shirts outside of spring training camps. That's it. I believe it was Speak American, and then he would sign them, take pictures with you.
What about Speak American?
The shirt said, like, Speak American. Like, that's what the shirt he was selling said.
He's selling these shirts?
Yeah, you can Google it. I guess that's what he's doing for a living nowadays.
So he's doubling down on all this.
He hangs out with Peter Roosevelt, I think.
Yeah. This is outside of where you say you sell them?
Like pretty much like the Hall of Fame. I'll go down.
Oh, so he will do that. Okay. Yeah, him and Pete Rose are quite a pair.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, looking at his Wikipedia page, it says he is using a Speak English campaign, as well as upping a book, Rocker Scars and Strikes. Rocker stated that the book will not be used to repair his reputation, but will rather be more conservative Republican rankings. And then he went on to make some statements about the Holocaust.
Wow. So we talked about some lovely people in this class. But again, he's got a name, right? Here we are, however many, 20 years removed from his last playing days, and we're talking about him. People know him. People know him. Not because of his pitching prowess. Because of this. And now this. It's really interesting that he has, in this politically correct world, he has not backed down from these statements. It almost sounds like the same train he's driving from years ago. Okay. John Rocker. Before we get to Sterling, who's an example of an owner that extreme happened to, complete extreme, did we talk about Iverson? Is someone going to talk about that?
Oh, Iverson? No. So Iverson.
Oh, yeah. It was interesting because back in when Iverson was a huge star, he made some rap lyrics that were very offensive to women. And I remember that was an issue for Commissioner Stern as well. And in that case, unlike these cases we're talking about, Allen Iverson was not disciplined. And this is what I talk about with precedent. Commissioner Stern and his legal team decided they're going to let it go. Again, you listen to some of the rap lyrics that Iverson was a rapper, if you didn't know that. And they were pretty misogynistic, and again, it was let go. You have to wonder what went into that thinking. Is it because Iverson was a star? Is it because so many players were getting into music and recording lyrics like this? Or maybe not that bad, but maybe would be that bad. So again, you're going to have things pop up like this all the time, and you're going to see situations like, well, there won't be discipline. You sort of wonder why not there and why here. Okay, when you see things out there in sports, you should ask yourself sometimes, why discipline there but not with another situation? And it's a legitimate question to ask, and it shows the difficulty and somewhat randomness sometimes of discipline. You want to protect your sport, you wanted that moral integrity, but there's so many situations that come up, you can't discipline every time. So you pick your spots. Rocker and shot. No one's going to lose any popularity disciplining them. Right. I think there would be some popularity loss disciplining Allen Iverson for that. Can't discount that. Leagues want to be popular. Management wants to be popular with fans. Get people to buy in, buy more tickets, sell more jerseys, all that stuff. Okay, and among the players putting out rap lyrics at that time were Shaquille O'Neal, Kobe Bryant. Again, I don't know what the lyrics were, but if they were approaching Iverson territory, you would have had to deal with that. Are you going to discipline those kind of superstars? Okay. And then after we leave the shot example of a one-year suspension for racist comments, we get to this 2 years ago. I talk a lot about the NFL kind of having a point in time where things changed with the Ray Rice video, which we'll talk about. I think this is a real point in time for the NBA where we had a real change in, I guess, sort of the social stance of the NBA. And it happened with the owner of the Clippers. I think it's a fascinating case. It's incredible discipline. Extraordinary is an understatement for what happened here in terms of the discipline. Imagine this happening to someone of your favorite team or your favorite owner where he actually loses the asset. Loses the asset. Where some of the most valuable assets in the world are professional sports franchises, whether in this country or overseas. Here is one that is taken away. Just a fascinating result based on some statements. Okay, who's talking about this? Tell me your name.
Alicia.
Alicia, go ahead.
Okay, well, Donald Sterling was recorded by a young female associate.
Associate?
I think it was like a girlfriend.
Yeah.
Yeah. the books of associate.
Something like that. No. I don't know quite what she was.
No. She recorded him saying, after she posted a picture on Instagram of her and Magic Johnson, she recorded their conversation, which basically was he asked her not to bring any black people to his games or associate with black men.
Mm-hmm.
And after the conversation was made public, he was...
How was it made public?
She recorded it and leaked it to a couple of media outlets, TMZ,
right. Okay, so they put it out there, and then what?
And then it was just got all this publicity and attention, and Adam Silver ended up banning him for life and gave him a huge time. And ultimately forced the sale of the Clippers.
Okay. And what do you think, or what did you read, as Silver's justification for this massive discipline?
His justification came from, I think, Article 13 of the NBA Constitution, which basically allowed him to definitely suspend indefinitely or definitely for any period if a person acts prejudicial or detrimental to the association. And so, specifically, just the public outcry, the player outrage, and major sponsorships from corporations for an initial withdrawal.
Okay. And you said player outrage. Do you remember, or did you read, what time of year this was?
It was right before the playoffs.
Yeah. Okay. So, was the worst part of his comments about not bringing Magic Johnson around? Was there much more than that? I'm trying to remember. Not hanging around.
Yeah, he was saying that he wasn't a racist, but and all these other things. But he didn't. He, I guess, just kind of circled around.
Okay, so a secretly recorded conversation with this woman, this associate, gets leaked and started a firestorm. As Alicia said, it was about to begin the NBA playoffs, which is a time of year where exactly the biggest time of year for the league. Because at that time of year, all these eyes from people who had a casual interest in the NBA all of a sudden show up, right? People who don't pay attention much all year, people who are casual fans at best, they pay attention during the playoffs. They stop in and see what's going on. And this is what the news they're faced with. That one of their owners makes these racist comments on a surreptitiously recorded statement, but it's out there. It's out there. Okay, so we have player protest, we have sponsors weighing what to do, and Adam Silver is a brand new commissioner. I think it was like that year he came in. And he levied the biggest fine he could according to the Constitution. And he basically sent this to the NBA owners on the best, all the powers that Alicia described to vote on his recommendation, on Adam Silver's recommendation to remove the franchise from Donald Sterling. Take the Clippers away, a franchise he had owned for 30 years. Now, yes, it was a sad sack of a franchise, no doubt. At that time. But it was getting better, right? They had a playoff team. And they're getting better, and they have Chris Paul, and they have Blake Griffin, and they're getting better. But then the minutia started with Donald Sterling bringing out lawsuits, Donald Sterling going on Anderson Cooper, Donald Sterling bad-mouthing Magic Johnson, and it just all bubbled up to the point where, again, this is extraneous, but he was now being evaluated for his psychological ability to withstand a trial, his ability to understand he could sell the team or how much or whatever it was. It was then reverted to his wife. He had a wife, in addition to having associates. And she had control of the team while he was undergoing the psychiatric evaluation. Long story short, there was a deadline for her to turn over take control of the team. He was about to be determined to either psychiatrically be able to fight this as team owner or not. In that 1 week window where she had the team, just think about this: the best way to negotiate possible. You know my saying from Twitter: deadlines for action. She had 1 week. And then it was going to go to the Board of Governors, and they were going to take the team and all that. She had 1 week where she was determined to be the owner of the team before he had his psychiatric evaluation announced. Brilliant. Whether it's her or her advisors, she put out bids to the richest people in the world, Oprah, Steve Ballmer. The highest sale in the history of the NBA prior to that was $500 million. She got $2 billion. She
got $2 billion. Four times the highest price in the history. She's got $2 billion. And then she and her would, and Donald would fight over how that's distributed. But the fact is, they came away with the most incredible sale ever, following the most incredible discipline ever. Okay, so listen, there are a lot to unpack about this. The fact is, you have a new commissioner that just levied the biggest discipline in the history of the NBA to a player or a coach or an owner. There's nothing like this. There's never been a situation where an owner was stripped of his team. Now, in those owner meetings, if you remember this, an owner that I think is about the smartest guy out there, Mark Cuban, he said, if you remember this, I don't know, we might be going down a slippery slope here. Those were the words. Because, and this is what you have to think of as a lawyer, I don't think Cuban's a lawyer, but what are we doing here? If we go inside the past of all of these owners, what they've said to people in their lives, there's probably some bad stuff out there. Are we going to take away their teams? What if we find out someone used the N-word? Someone made an anti-Semitic remark. Are we going to take away their teams? Now, Cuban made those comments, and then there was a ton of backlash against him because the world was up in arms about Sterling, remember? And Cuban backed off. He voted, because then it was unanimous. He voted against Sterling. And as I've said all along, in a lot of these cases, popularity matters. Sterling was obviously a hated owner. Hated by players, hated by the league, hated by other owners. That mattered. They took his team away. Now he walks away between he, his wife, and whatever executors, walks away with an incredible amount of money, $2 billion. But I'm sure if you ask him, he'd rather have the team, right? Get a lot of enjoyment from owning an NBA team. They took it away based on secretly recorded conversation. And again, I understand the firestorm, but if you look at it from a detached perspective of a lawyer, which Adam Silver is, it seems really harsh. And it seems like you've got the slippery slope argument. All right? What if we find out about other owners, not only in basketball, in other sports, that have said these terrible things? We've got precedent on the books now. We'll take away the team. Jason?
I think Sterling is a lot different, though. I think
Going
back to when he started as an owner, I think he's probably been the most internally hated owner in professional sports history. And there's evidence from certain people in the NBA talking him. He was overtly racist his entire time as owner of the Clippers. And I think that video was just the public justification for something that...
You mean the audio?
Yeah. Getting those tapes was justification for what the NBA wanted to do for so long.
If you're a lawyer for Sterling, which I know no one wants to be, that's the question you ask, though. Is this a suspension or a takeaway a team, whatever you call it, for this, or for 30 years of being a scumbag? Because the rationale that I see here is for these comments. If the rationale is for 30 years of being a scumbag, okay, well, let's talk about that. But this seems to be about one conversation.
I think that's a justification, but not necessarily the only motivation, right? This has been something. If you look at what Doc Rivers said during this time, he has dozens and dozens of stories of
saying
worse things than he did on tape, right? So I think this was just a way to sell it to the public and some media And this was kind of the opportunity they needed to get rid of him.
What do you think they got rid of him for?
I would think a little bit of both. I think, you know, damaging the league's reputation. I think if they kept him on, it would have been a tough hit to the league's reputation. But I think internally, I think it's for everything that happened up until then.
What would you have done?
I would have done the same thing. I think it was necessary. I think if someone wrote an oral history of the Clippers organization, you'd find that, you know, it was probably one of the worst run businesses in, you know, history.
I would agree with that. I have a good Clippers story for later in the semester. They were a joke. Really a joke of the franchise. And now, of course, the most valuable franchise in all of sports, based on purchase price. It's amazing. But again, if you're Steve Ballmer and you've got $60 billion in the bank, yeah, I'll throw a couple at a sports team, why not? Right? To him, the fact that the last team sold for $500 million, who cares? He's sitting at home, got a call from Shelley Sterling. You want to buy a team? Yeah. Why not? Got $50 billion of Microsoft money in my bank. Yeah, okay. What do you want for it? $1 billion? I'll give you two. I can see that conversation happening. Again, if you remember, Oprah was involved, Magic was involved, all these people, the biggest names in entertainment and sports, and I'm sure they're all bidding around $1 billion, which would have been twice the most profitable franchise. Ballmer's like, yeah, I'll give you two. Why not? So yeah, I mean, and all ownership in all sports had to smile because... Yes, you can say it's an anomaly, and it certainly is, but now you've got a price out there, right? So now you can say, whether you have an NBA team or you have an NFL team in Los Angeles now, or you have other people talking about selling their franchises, that's a data point now, that $2 billion price. Massive ripples around the industry. Okay. These are some sort of follow-up things that we've talked about with these situations, and it really was triggered again by what's happening now with Kaepernick, where you just have these commissioners having to deal with this. So you look about what about comments like this? Where does freedom of speech come in? Where do you look at to discipline and or not discipline? And should a private employer be permitted to punish or fire an employee whose public speech, okay, because everyone in pro sports is public because it gets so much attention, might embarrass or injure the employer's business? Okay? Sometimes, whether it's Allen Iverson's rap lyrics or whatever, sometimes you stay away. Or Colin Kaepernick, you stay away. In the best interest of the sport, you do not get involved. Other times we see Commissioner Power getting very involved. And these ownership examples are fascinating because... maybe more to me than you, but I just think that when you have the setup that you have in pro sports with ownership hiring, firing, and paying the commissioner to essentially discipline not only players, but owners as well, is just a unique setup. I'm not sure there's any business like that. The other thing that, you know, the one theme that we seem to have every year when I teach this class, we get hit with big-time news, and now it's a theme, I believe, starting with this Kaepernick thing. We have seen that Kaepernick, as I suggested, was never going to be a one-off event. It was not an isolated incident. It has legs. It has staying power. It is something being talked about on news stations as well as sports stations every day. It has filtered down from NFL to colleges to high schools. It has gone from NFL to soccer. It will become an issue when we start hockey and basketball. It is going to be something we continue to talk about. In the same genre, we have huge news coming out the past couple days of another situation in sports. Huge news. This North Carolina bill that is called the bathroom bill, relating to LGBT rights, has caused issues. And among the fallout, as you know, before this week, the NBA All-Star Game scheduled for Charlotte has pulled out, and they've relocated to New Orleans. That's a one-time event. Now we have the NCAA last night, or two nights ago. The NCAA has pulled out their championships in North Carolina. And then an hour ago in the news, the ACC, Atlantic Coast Conference, based in North Carolina, has scrubbed its championships in North Carolina. So there's something happening here. Reese, you want to talk about this? This sort of what's going on now? Because now we have another big event in sports law happening right before us.
Sure. The issue which surrounds the HB2 or the bathroom bill that you previously talked about. And North Carolina has now been stripped of 7 championship events that were to take place in the upcoming year. In North Carolina, the NCAA has a culture of fairness and equality and inclusion that they stress in their constitution. And they said that the dynamic in North Carolina is a lot different from other states, and they cited the 4 main factors that led to their decision. One was that North Carolina laws invalidate any local law that treats sexual orientation as a protected class or has a purpose to prevent discrimination against lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender individuals. North Carolina has the only statewide law that makes it unlawful to use a restroom different from the gender on one's birth certificate, regardless of gender identity. North Carolina law provides legal protections for government officials to refuse services to LGBT community members. And also there's 5 states up to this point that have they prohibited travel to North Carolina for public employees and representatives of institutions that include student athletes and campus athletic staff members. New York, Minnesota, Washington, Vermont, and Connecticut have all said that public employees can't go to those places. And I remember, I've read up on some of the reactions to it, and I remember when it first came out that there was a school in New York that canceled a trip to Duke and changed up their schedule because obviously this has been going on, this is an issue. So, and like you said, the ACC pulled out today at around 1:30, so just a few hours before class, they pulled all championships from North Carolina. The only championships that are allowed to be played there at this point are on the NCAA's behalf. Are the championships that the North Carolina student athletes earned the opportunity to play on their own home turf. So I thought that was interesting that they'll still be allowed to play. Say, for example, North Carolina soccer team makes it to the championship and they're allowed to play on their home turf. There was a lot of reaction. A representative from the Republican Party in North Carolina said the decision was pretty much ridiculous.
Who said that?
a representative from the Republican Party, Kenny Mueller.
So the decision of the NCAA and ACC to pull out is ridiculous?
Yeah, it was ridiculous, and actually her exact quote was, it's so absurd that it's almost comical. She was saying that she sort of used the rape incidents that happened at Baylor to say the NCAA should essentially be worried about things that actually concern the NCAA and not focus their energies on political peacocking. And that got a lot of backlash. There's been a lot of talk about those comments. Stephen A. Smith and Chris Broussard talked about it on SportsCenter a few days ago.
What is the rationale for the new North Carolina law? Is it a religious thing?
So they basically rationalize it by saying that they want to protect the student athletes, and they say, like, basically the NCAA is saying, North Carolina is saying that the NCAA says that female athletes can essentially share locker rooms and bathrooms with football players, and they say that there's no protection for it's an assault on female athletes is their rationale. So they're trying to protect the integrity. If you have a women's basketball team, their mindset is you should have a women's locker room, a women's bathroom, and that's how things should be.
But the law is not designed for athletics, correct?
No.
It's simply a societal law.
Yes.
But their response is more on the athletic side. You're infiltrating the women's teams.
Yeah, that's at least the argument against the NCAA's decision.
Right. I know it's not the popular thing, but can anyone defend the North Carolina law here? From a sports angle? What do we think of this? What do you think of these leagues pulling out?
I agree with it. I mean, there's such a large audience and fan base that the NCAA has, and it's written in their constitution. Their values are inclusion, equality, and I think that a law that the HB2 law is not inclusive, and for the NCAA to support that and not take a stance like this, basically them saying, you know, we support this law, even if they don't explicitly say that, that's how it looks.
I think there's pressure for North Carolina to change it, but based on that woman's statement, it doesn't sound like they're going that direction.
Yeah.
But I just wonder if before these NCAA championships are actually going to happen, or ACC, or even the NBA All-Star Game, what if they change? What if the law changes? What if their powerful statement has affected change? Do they then come back? Cody?
I think they took a very tactical approach in it. Specifically, the ACC announced that they were just removing the championships for 2016-2017 season, so this year. I know specifically with the football, the baseball tournament in Durham for the ACC championship, all those were typically four-year contracts. So they only removed it for this year, and they're finding replacements. But assuming this law changes, there's three more years on that contract, so it'll revert right back to that. But what's interesting about it is that I think it's putting pressure on the government officials that are making these decisions, your representatives and stuff like that, because the ramifications really hurt the local businesses the most. I lived in Raleigh for 3 years before I went to law school, so I have a lot of friends there that are really upset, like photographers and things like that, because NCAA championships are gone, all the ACC championships are gone. That's how they work. That's when they are paid to take photographs and all the businesses around the Durham Bulls Stadium and around the Charlotte football stadium, those are going to lose big revenue opportunities that they were banking on. So those people are going to really push the change, I think.
And you live there. Do you think this is a state that will respond to this kind of activism and make changes?
It is. It's a very red state, typically, very Republican state. But I think at the same time, at least the people I'm still very connected with, a lot of the young people there are very upset about this. There's been such major repercussions, and it seems like the Republican representatives are very staunch in their stance in this. Reese was reading that quote that saying that. Kind of flipping this back on the NCAA, that the NCAA is now devaluing women by taking these championships away for inequality bill, like that's counterintuitive. So I think you could see more, especially on the local level in the elections coming up, you could see more Democratic representatives elected in that state than usual because of the ramifications of this.
Well, the governor doesn't seem to be budging. So is we've got NCAA, we've got ACC, we've got NBA. Is there anything else scheduled to come from North Carolina? We got concerts pulling out, right? Springsteen and others. I wonder what could make a change.
I was going to say, part of North Carolina, like the Wilmington area, is one of the biggest places to shoot movies in the country outside of Hollywood and Los Angeles. And I'd be curious to see if there's, if that kind of continues, like all the Hunger Games movies and all those are shot in North Carolina. And if actors and directors start pulling out of that business, would have huge, huge ramifications there, tax money, things like that.
Good point, sir.
I know Marvel already pulled out, so they used to film all the Avengers, Captain America, all in there, and they pulled all that out.
Fascinating. I mean, like you said, the ancillary businesses, think of all that. All that. I mean, these are major events. Okay, so it's quite a time. All right, let's take a quick break. We'll come back. Our guest has arrived. We'll introduce him in about 5 to 10 minutes. So I'm going to let you talk about your background and sort of how you landed and
sure.
An instructional model for them, and then I'll ask some questions.
Great. Well, thank you. Second class? First class?
Third.
Wow. You guys went back early.
Fourth.
Okay. Excellent. As Professor mentioned, I'm a Villanova graduate. Graduated in 2010. So I was in your seats not too long ago. I came out of law school and I always wanted to do corporate transactional type of work, and the market just wasn't there in 2010 after the market crashed in 2009. So I ended up getting a job at a Philly-based firm in their gaming group, which is part of corporate but doing gaming, transactional, regulatory work. Really liked it, spent 2 years there. We didn't really, my first firm, we didn't do a ton of daily fantasy sports. We kind of looked at a couple sports, betting-ish type products, but not a lot more traditional gaming, a little internet gaming. Went to another firm after 2 years, a lateral. Still doing the gaming regulatory type of work, traditional gaming, casino work, buying and selling casinos, representing investors. But in my new firm, we do a little bit more of the internet work and then daily fantasy. A couple of traditional gaming companies a few years ago came to us, said, hey, we want to know more about this daily fantasy thing. We think it's popping up. How can we get into it? So we gave some opinions on it, and our opinions were always very soft in the sense that, it's probably legal and we can make a case why it's legal, but it's very much an unfounded area of the law, and you need to tread with, a great deal of caution. So that was sort of our fantasy interest initially. Then as FanDuel and DraftKings started to get really big, the calls started to come more and more. And we just saw it as maybe these companies are outgrowing themselves a little bit, and maybe they're getting out in front of their skis too much. And then fast forward to last probably fall. A good friend of mine from college called me. He worked for a crisis management political strategy firm that got retained by one of the companies, by FanDuel. And he said, what do you know about this? And we started talking, and he said, well, you know, they don't really have regulatory type of counsel like this. So I talked to the guys in my office, and we had a partner who's no longer with the firm, but was a former gaming regulator. We brought him in, and we ended up pitching, and they brought us in to do a lot of their compliance type of work, or at least advising them on dealing with gaming regulators. So we helped FanDuel for several months as they were going through the crisis. The states were cracking down on them on the gaming regulatory side, going to meet with gaming regulators, advising them on the types of issues they might see and the types of things that gaming regulators might do to them in the future. We commented on their pending legislation, which now they've passed in a bunch of states. So we were kind of in the thick of things for a while with you know, with these companies, and FanDuel and DraftKings always worked together. That's sort of my background, how I got into fantasy. My practice now, we do a little bit of daily fantasy work. It's sort of dried up as the companies have, you know, come out of this situation. And I'm doing a lot more, you know, traditional casino gaming, but with definitely with an eye on sports betting and the developments there, which I don't know if you guys have been following at all, but pretty big decision a couple weeks ago. You know, in New Jersey, which might affect the the future of sports betting. So that's sort of my background, but if anyone's questions about that, obviously happy to take them or move into the subject.
Not you, when you said your sort of friend from college called and sort of did that, was like, this sounds interesting, this sounds cool, I'd love to work on this, or it was like, I don't know what you're talking about?
No, it was definitely something that we knew about. We had been, just as gaming lawyers, something we try to do is follow the current trends in the industry. So we knew what was happening at FanDuel and DraftKings. We were kind of looking as a gaming group, as a firm, to get into it, and just kind of waiting for an opportunity. Then my friend called. He said, hey, our company, his political strategy firm, got retained by them. We saw it as an opportunity for me to work with him. I'd never worked with him before, purely a social friendship up until that point. But we were able to make a pitch, put together some materials, and he was able to walk it into, the team at FanDuel and make some introductions, to their general counsel and some other people in their legal staff. And that kind of opened the door for us and, led to a good experience.
Do you consider yourself a sports lawyer?
I consider myself a gaming lawyer who does a lot of sports. Sports and gaming, they interact in a lot of ways, particularly sports betting, daily fantasy sports. A lot of the internet gaming products that you see out there kind of toe the line, I'll say. So I think we have to, in our practice, understand what sports law is and the areas there. Our firm doesn't have a dedicated sports law group. But when issues come in that kind of are on the edge, lawyers will refer it to me and the other guys I work with.
And can you describe better for us what a gaming lawyer does?
Sure. So there's a lot of different things. It's like any other, practice, based on an industry that we represent a lot of different companies in the industry. I would say my work is, generally speaking, corporate, transactional. We do some regulatory work. So we'll represent casinos, companies who sell, slot machines, table games, casinos. We represent a lot of investors in casinos and, slot machine manufacturers. And what we'll typically do for them is, help them with mergers and acquisitions, help them with development. For example, right now we're representing a company who just got a gaming license in New York. They're planning to open up in a couple months, hopefully. So we're assisting them understand the regulations and prepare to, run a full-scale casino. We help companies just interpret regulations, I would say, on a daily basis. Because in the gaming industry, everything that a casino does or an online gaming company does is regulated to follow really specific rules. So we help them make sure they're always following protocol and doing everything the right way. It's an interesting practice because every day is a little bit different. Every project's a little bit different, and what we're called on to do is always a little different. For example, in this New York project we're working on right now, we're really advising on operational issues, helping them get their, it's called internal controls together, which will say, you know, this is how you run your table games, this is how you run your slot machines, this is how you have to get, you know, gaming equipment delivered, this is how you're going to have to deal with problem gamblers. So it's always unique, always different. You know, and then just going back to your prior question, you know, in terms of sports law, it's something that we would, you know, are always looking to grow into, and we're hoping that at some point in time, you know, sports betting or something close to it becomes legal, so that we can, you know, we can participate in that as well.
And then I'll ask another, and then open it up. The FanDuel DraftKings saga, if you will, that we read about and talked about last week. Just shocking growth, and now a retrenchment. You know, as someone who's been in the heart of that, where do you see it now? We've had sort of down numbers for the beginning of the season, at least football.
Sure.
Yeah, where are we on this?
So I think where you are is you're at a place where the companies are certainly smaller than they were in terms of geographic areas they can target. The companies have been very successful in getting regulations passed in, you know, a fair amount of jurisdiction, so they can legally operate now in a lot of places, which is a big step forward from where they were, you know, the end of last football season, which is good. The problem is both companies spend so much money on lobbying, on lawyers, you know, on different fees to kind of get where they are, and they've also had some major setbacks. You know, they lost Texas, New York they were out of for a long time, so they've lost a lot of money, and now I think the companies are in a place where they have a revenue issue. They're not necessarily generating the revenue that they need. You know, for example, last week both companies made guarantees of prize money, you know, like the $1 million prize pools I think FanDuel offered, and neither company had enough entries to pay those fees. That might be a product of them not spending as much on advertising. They're not spending as much on advertising, I think, because they don't have probably the funds to do it. But also, equally importantly, they're not spending as much money on advertising because I think they learned the hard way last year that if you're not on absolutely 100% sound legal footing, you need to tread very lightly with advertising, and they didn't want to do a blitz like they did. So I think those have all set the companies back from a business standpoint. So their future, I think they have to, if they want to stay in the same business they're in, they need to grow their footprint and have more states adopt, you know, models like Indiana, for example, or Virginia, where it's completely legal and people feel safe and secure playing the games. So I think that's their future. I also think that, you know, sports betting sort of plays in. You know, there was a point in time where sports betting became legalized in this country. I always thought that FanDuel and DraftKings then become your brand names. You know, there's a lot of companies who offer sports betting, you know, in Vegas Sportsbook, but no one really knows, at least broadly, except for people who gamble a lot, who those companies are. And FanDuel and DraftKings could have become those brand names, was always sort of my thought. But now that's looking, at least at the moment, less likely.
It's a weird question, but we're talking a lot about this. Do you think FanDuel and DraftKings are, quote unquote, gambling?
I will say, we've worked with them, and the argument would be that they're not gambling. They offer a game of skill or a contest of skill, and in under the laws of most states, I think it's a close call, but I think they fall on the line where, you know, they probably don't meet the technical definition of gambling, but, you know, when a layperson looks at it, I think it looks very close to gambling, but from a technical standpoint, I would say no in most states. But, you know, the thing with gambling laws is every state has their own unique laws. And even though the actual statutes of the states oftentimes look very similar, the way their attorney general is interpreted, the way their case law interpreted, can be very unique. So, you know, that's sort of the challenge, I think, for lawyers in the space, is that, you know, anyone can look at a statute and kind of say, this is my opinion on it, but you really have to get into the weeds on this. And the other problem, too, with daily fantasy sports is when a lot of these laws were drafted, the internet didn't exist. And certainly daily fantasy sports, or in some cases, fantasy sports in general, didn't exist. So you're now taking laws that are somewhat antiquated and trying to apply it to, you know, to the modern products. And I think that's a very tough thing. And I think that's one area where I give FanDuel and DraftKings, I think, a lot of credit, was when they eventually made the decision they need to go to states, they wrote laws that were very tailored to daily fantasy sports, and it makes it a 100% clear-cut cut situation. So do I think it's legal? Do I think it's gambling or not? I think it depends on the state. I think in almost any state, I could probably find an argument that it's not, but would the Attorney General there agree with me or not, I think is maybe the better question.
And then you and I were talking before we started here with the number of lawyers and lobbyists working for these companies at one point last year.
Sure. I don't have an exact number, but I know the companies combined probably spent $50, $60 million, from the start of football season last year until the summertime or so, just on lawyers and lobbyists. And these are companies that were not making extraordinary revenue at the time. So those are really interesting just numbers to think about. And I think when you talk about FanDuel and DraftKings, about the companies going forward, you have to think about it economically. Is this a viable business model? And is it viable for two separate companies to exist? I mean, if you read I'm not sure if the ESPN article mentioned it, but a lot of the press about them right now contemplates a merger between the two companies. And I think that would be a merger of more efficiency. Realizing that the two companies already collaborate a lot of the laws that were passed, a lot of lobbying that was done were the two companies combined. So a merger in some cases, might make sense. From a personality business standpoint, I think that's for the companies have to determine.
Questions?
You mentioned how last week that the two companies weren't able to fill a lot of their large contests.
Yeah.
Do you think that's a product of consumers realizing that only a small percentage of players actually are profitable because these sharks can come up with their algorithms and add multiple entries into a single contest? And if so, what do you think the companies can do to combat that so it's more viable to the large majority of people?
Sure. I think absolutely that's part of the problem. I mentioned before, I think the decreased advertising affected, their prize or their entry pool last week. But absolutely, I think people, read the paper, they watch the news, they watch all the attention that these two companies and this industry has been getting. And they, as you said, it's dominated by a few players who are really professionals. They literally do nothing else but run algorithms all day, and they can, win at a very high percentage, and they play a lot of money, and they do enter multiple times. So yeah, I think absolutely that's a factor, and I think that takes the casual player out of the contest. What can the companies do? And I think you're seeing they're offering beginner tournaments to people. I think that's helpful. That gets people in. It shows them, hey, everyone can win. They're offering contests where 50% of the players have to win, 50-50s. I think that's an important step, because I think if people go in and they win, I think they feel confident and they grow and they keep playing. But the biggest thing I think the companies need to do is be as transparent as possible. They need to set forth their rules. They need to make their rules known to know that they are trying to limit multiple entries, because that's one of the things they're trying to do. Now, every rule they put in place, every algorithm they put on their system to sort of block those multiple entries, there's going to be a computer whiz who's going to try to get around it. So that's sort of the downside. I think ultimately people might realize that they're never going to win. But I think transparency and getting the message out that we're trying to be as fair as possible. The other thing that I think does help is now that these companies are regulated, they are following standards. Before, they were self-regulated. So they just did, they put in the protocols they felt were necessary. That's in terms of underage players, problem gamblers, and then cheaters, I think being the biggest issue. It was up to them to enforce whether or not their players were allowed to play on their websites. Now that they're regulated, they can't, by state law, do that. And I think that gives the public confidence. So I think for them going forward, they really need to get the word out about that. That, hey, we are regulated companies. If you were going to go gamble, think about it, you would feel more comfortable going into a casino, in Pennsylvania, or go to Harris, or go to Atlantic City, into a casino there where there's people watching, everything they do is monitored, than going to, you know, some back room of a bar where they just have a gaming table. You know you're probably going to, there's a good chance you're going to get cheated there. So I think it's the same type of thing.
Identify yourself.
We discussed that each one of the daily fantasy companies has like individual contracts with the different teams.
Yes.
Along with the major sport brand itself. With the decision that just came down in New Jersey, what's the next step with the team, the Giants, the Jets, and the teams that are playing out in New Jersey?
You know, and that's a great question. So the New Jersey decision, just a little background, was whether the federal law that bans sports betting, or at least prevents states from authorizing sports betting, was constitutional. Well, the first challenge was whether it was constitutional or not. Ultimately, it was held as constitutional. And then whether or not New Jersey's workaround, which would have allowed sports betting to take place in casinos and racetracks, whether that was legal. That's a question. Now, the sports leagues challenged the state and said, you can't do this, sports betting is illegal. So I think the sports teams in a lot of ways took hypocritical positions. You know, on one hand, they're spending a lot of money, they're litigating issues, saying sports betting shouldn't happen. On the other hand, they're supporting daily fantasy sports, and they've always done that. I don't see them backing off of that. I think daily fantasy sports brings a lot of attention to their games, the NFL in particular. People watch, two last place teams play now because they have guys in the game, and I think the NFL loves that. But I do, flat out think it's hypocritical. They don't support sports betting, which will offer the same exact thing. You know, the NFL is even talking about moving a team to Las Vegas. So, I don't think you can necessarily view the NFL as hypocrisy. It's sort of the standard by which you sort of measure daily fantasy sports by. So I don't see it going away, and I think you're going to see the endorsements increase as long as the sports leagues and the sports teams view these companies as profitable and as targeting the right types of people. You know, if there comes a point where people stop playing daily fantasy sports, yeah, the endorsements are 100% going to go away, but it's great advertising for them. And it's been a profitable partnership on both sides. Yeah, good question.
Yeah, with sports and video, intersecting venues.
Alex?
Sorry, I'm Alex.
Hey, Alex.
With sports and gaming intersecting in Vegas with the NHL going there next year, do you think a lot's kind of riding on the success of that with, players getting hurt and, gambling being successful? Do you think that'll affect if an NFL team goes there, if gambling will be legal in Jersey or something like that?
I think two very different questions. I think absolutely what happens with the NHL will affect it. I mean, I think the NHL, obviously, while a major sports league, is not on the level revenue-wise of the NFL and just doesn't have the same attention. But I think if the NHL can prove successful there, there's obviously a lot of challenges in Vegas. Aside from the sports betting thing, you have a small market. Not a lot of residents live in the area. But looking past that, if they can get by the integrity issues, I think that probably moves the NFL closer to moving a team there. Then the second question you ask is, does that, I think, challenge the sports leagues to, maybe take a different position than they've taken against sports betting? Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. If they think that they can be profitable without turning their views completely, I think they probably do that. Does there come a point, though, where the American public really just sees the sort of the hypocritical position that they're taking and sort of forces that change? That certainly could also happen. But I think the NHL moving there is going to be a big first step. And I think the Raiders, obviously there's a lot of talk about them making a move. That would be a huge splash. The NFL, I think they've sort of started the precedent for that already by playing games in London. In London, there's sports books on every corner, actually in Wembley Stadium, where they play now a few games a year.
Yep.
There's sports books in the stadium. I think they close them during, they actually shut them down during NFL games, but they're there and you can walk across the street from, leave the game, walk across the street and place a bet. So far, nothing catastrophic has happened. So I think the comfort level by the leagues is certainly growing.
I'm Rob.
Hey, Rob.
Why do you think, kind of going off that, why do you think the sports leagues have taken such a strong anti-gambling position or traditional sports gambling, yet have been completely okay with the new way, the newer version of sports gambling?
I think that's a great question, and I think a lot of it is this was their old school belief. This is what they believed in, going back to probably before this, the 1920s with, the Black Sox scandal, that betting and sports are bad. You go forward to, Pete Rose, betting and sports are bad. And I think they've always had to take this hardline approach. And then they realized that, hey, maybe we can make money off of this. So they found Daily Fantasy Sports, they could found a partner they can partner with, grow their brands. While at the same time not technically saying sports betting is okay. The one thing is that surprised me is how hard they've actually fought, in New Jersey, for example, to keep sports betting still be considered illegal under federal law. They made such a hard push. They spent, tens of millions of dollars to fight this. At the same time, when the leagues, I think, the NBA at least, has sort of softened their view a little bit and said, maybe at some point we'll be okay with sports betting. None of the leagues have said we endorse sports betting, but their position is softened. At least publicly, but their actual actions have not changed yet. I think it would have been very interesting to see had the state of New Jersey prevailed and sports betting became illegal in some way, shape, or form, what the leagues would have done. On the one hand, they could have said, hey, we're gonna, New Jersey got away with it, but we're gonna fight every other state who tries to do it, and every, small growth of this decision, we're gonna fight. On the other hand, maybe they would have just taken the position, well, we tried, we lost, and, kind of in the back room giving each other high fives at sports betting, is now around, and they're going to find a way to make money off of it. I mean, I think, sort of going back to your question, when they moved teams to Vegas, they're probably going to profit off of sports betting indirectly. I mean, the NFL already does. The amount of money wagered on the Super Bowl is, astronomical, most of it being illegal sports gambling. So, and that's sort of just your other point, or related. The sports leagues, they talk a lot about integrity and, the integrity of the game. Regulated sports betting might move you closer to that as opposed to what happens now, which are, illegal bookies, offshore websites, which have no regulations over them. They can do whatever they want, and there's not really a lot known about them. You still see Bodog commercials and, things like that are all over the place. So it's interesting to see at what point do the sports leagues kind of realize, hey, this is the world we live in. Let's start, either embracing it or, take a different position. I think we'll see. If the sports betting law that New Jersey tried to pass gets tried in another state and another circuit takes it up, it'll be interesting to see if the leagues fight as hard too. So, unfortunately, right now it's not a lot known, but you will soon.
Hi, I'm Whitney. So, as you mentioned earlier, gambling is very state to state.
Yeah.
So, a multi-state platform such as DraftKings, what were some of the regulatory issues inherent with that? There, I know, for example, I'm pretty sure they make their revenues from players where you pay $1 per entry, only 80 cents of that dollar goes into the pool that can be paid out. That's going to make their money based on the number of transactions,
right?
Pretty much. So what if one state it's, you can only do 13%, or another state it's, 17, or et cetera?
That's a great question. And I think that's something that these companies, when they've taken a state-by-state approach in a lot of ways because they had to. New York comes to you and says, hey, we're going to shut you down, or, we're shutting you down effectively now. You then have to negotiate with New York. And you're, in some ways, have to agree to what they say, that they have the leverage. Another state comes to you and they're going to shut you down. They now have the leverage. So you need to make both these states happy, and what makes New York happy and what makes that other state happy might not be the same thing. I think you hit on one of the biggest expenses and problems these companies are going to have. Technologically, is it possible to break down dollars differently? If I'm in New Jersey and you're in Pennsylvania, we both play in the same contest, is it possible for them to follow all the regulations and for break down our money differently? Absolutely, but is there a huge expense to doing that? you know, it's more programming time, it's more employees they have to hire. The other problem that they're, you know, seeing is, you know, from an advertising perspective, you know, they can advertise a contest across the country, but not everyone who sees the advertisement is allowed to play. So if I'm sitting in, you know, a state where it's still legal, or it's still illegal, if I'm sitting in Texas, I see a DraftKings commercial during a football game, I'm going to try to log on, I'm going to say, hey, I want to play that. They have to have a system, FanDuel and DraftKings, to know exactly where I'm located and to block me. That's called, you know, geo-compliance. And that's a major expense, too, because now you have to bring an outside vendor who does a lot of this. And then just to, you know, couple that on top of the problem, states might have different standards for what effective geo-compliance is. You know, for example, New Jersey allows internet gaming, if any of you guys are, you know, familiar. In New Jersey, you have to have what's called double authenticated verification, which means that if I log on my, you know, computer from in New Jersey, it will check my IP address where I'm logging in from. But then I also have to get another method of authentication. So they might send a text message to my phone. I respond to that text message. Now they've verified where I am in two different ways. So you may have different standards of that coming on board in daily fantasy sports. So the companies now need to, you know, accommodate that. And there's different problem gambling standards. And the other thing that you're seeing a lot of in daily fantasy sports are different age limits. You know, Massachusetts, for example, you have to be 21 years old to play. Most states is 18. There's a few states that are 19 by statute. So you now have to have different age requirements in every state. And every time there's a unique requirement, that's unique coding that needs to be built in. And that's just more people who have to verify it and another thing to look at. So, yeah, the cost keeps skyrocketing. So a national solution would be great, but you're probably not going to see that. Yeah.
I'm Joey. This is less about the legality of DFS, but do you foresee any like antitrust problems with FanDuel and DraftKings merging together? I know that's not happening right as of now, but in the future, could that be a problem?
And I'm in no way an antitrust lawyer. I have a working knowledge of it. But yeah, I mean, I think absolutely when you see an industry that's dominated by two players merging, yeah, you're going to see those. Because there are some other small companies in the space right now, but their market share is, you know, maybe a couple percent at most. So yeah, you absolutely are going to get antitrust scrutiny. Will it pass or not? I don't think I'm the expert to make that call.
And going off the antitrust for the companies merging, aren't some states incorporating a $10,000 startup fee that DraftKings and FanDuel wouldn't have to pay, but it's a certain barrier to entry for any new startup?
So I think the way in some cases they've been, it's grandfathered in, but the way those fees, at least from what I've seen in a lot of states, are that the big companies, where they have a certain amount based on revenue, I think they typically do it, they'll have to pay one license fee, where small companies may get a reduced license fee. Starting a new company, but the one thing where there will be expenses, they'll have to file all new applications in the states. When you're a gaming company, and they're now these companies in a lot of places are regulated by gaming regulators who have a very old school view. So for example, if you sell a casino, you need to have approval of that sale before you can transfer any of the interest, before you get new investors, before you get new debt, any real changes. So now these companies, not only are they going to have to agree on business terms, and which, you know, can be tough to get onto a timeline and get all their financing in place to make the merger happen, but they're also going to have to line up their regulators and get their regulators on board to support that, which will make it a much slower process. So these are all things that being a regulated company, the downside. And that's why I did gaming lawyers. But it's something that these companies really need to think about. It's going to slow them down anything that they do in the future, you know, including merger.
And speaking of hypocrisy, when you have an attorney general like Shimon come in under the guise of preventing addictive gambling, I mean, do you see through that just more of a legislative getting their piece of the revenue that comes from this, or is it a real consumer protection thing?
I think there is a consumer protection thing underlying it all, but I think the consumer protection side can easily be handled.
I don't think you need to outlaw something to add consumer protections in. And we were doing a lot of work for FanDuel. Those were things we were really advising them on. How do you make your product safer? You know, we talked about geo-compliance. Hey, you need to geo-comply. You need to make sure that kids aren't playing on your game. Because the worst thing that could happen for one of these companies is that they find out that a 13-year-old lost, you know, $10,000 of their parents' money. You know, that, those are some worries that you don't want to see, and they haven't really happened yet, but they could. But I think those are all very preventable things. When Schneiderman comes in and says that's a concern, yeah, I think there are absolutely underlying tone. But at the same time, New York has been one of the most aggressively expanding gambling states in the, you know, in the country. They just, you know, they just, you know, they're opening, they've awarded 4 casino licenses in the past year. They're opening 4, they're going to have 3 more coming in the New York City area in a few years. So for him to say that gambling is bad and take an anti-gambling approach, I think it's somewhat hypocritical because of what New York does. And, you know, the other thing too with, you know, we're working a lot in New York right now, and we're trying to get gaming regulations passed so we can open our casino, and we're trying to work with the Gaming Commission to speed things up. They were able to put out regulations for daily fantasy sports in record time. Like, they put everything else aside, and that was, again, because there was political energy behind it over the summer that you know, they made a deal with DraftKings and FanDuel, let's get this process moving, and they got the regulations out, you know, in light speed. And they were protected, their regulations are really thorough. So yeah, so they were able to do it when they wanted to. So when I think Schneiderman came out last December and said, hey, this industry is, you know, effectively bad and dangerous and there's no way to keep it safe, I think that was political posturing. And the other thing that we always saw with, you know, DraftKings and FanDuel and DLI Fantasy Sports in general is that when you have an industry that, even though, you know, it's 51% legal, but when it's like that close and the scales are that close, that all it takes is one aggressive, you know, attorney general starting trying to make a name for himself, one young U.S. attorney who wants to become senator. You know, they go out there and they put up a political fight. They've created a name, and that's, I think, what Schneiderman did. There's a history of New York attorney generals becoming governor, and I think he saw that as the opportunity. You know, you kind of, you know, when you're an attorney general, you can try a lot of cases, but sometimes it's more important for them to try the ones that get them the most media attention. And I think Schneiderman saw this as, you know, an opportunity to tell you.
Yeah, especially, I mean, they have lottery, they have casinos.
Yeah, they have what? They have every type of game. You know, they have tribal casinos, commercial casinos, video lottery, terminals, regular lottery.
But it's fantasy that'll drive the populace into degeneration.
Exactly. And a lot of it, too, with these states where that they realize all those other types of gaming you mentioned, the state gets a cut.
Right.
And, you know, typically a significant cut in New York, you know, for example, on their video lottery machines, they make, you know, upwards of 50% depending on the casino. They were getting absolutely nothing from FanDuel and DraftKings. Yeah, maybe they're getting some income tax, some income earned in the state, but, you know, that's really nothing. So they wanted to take, and that's why you see all these regulations coming out. Now when they impose, you know, 5%, 10%, 15% tax on them. So that's money right in the state pocket. And that's something that legislators go back to their home, you know, their home districts about and, you know, blow it out. And that's another thing incentive behind all the legislation now. Does anyone play? Do you think it's different this year?
I don't know. It seems like the entries were less overall people, and before there was more high price entries. Now I think a lot of people are toning it back if they're not outright discouraged from playing. So I think a lot of players are kind of wary that, but they're at least more aware that their chances of winning are slimmer than it makes it look like.
Yeah.
So I think the player shifts down a little bit.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. Anything was harder to sign up, log on, any more groups you to jump through?
It does always ask to verify my location every time I have to re-sign on. Not too much has changed in that regard.
Well, do you feel, are there more protections, do you feel, like questions about age or experience, any of that?
Mm, Not really. I mean, when you first sign up, you have to certify your 18. It doesn't like always have a reminder there or anything.
It just seems like you just sign back up. Like you log into Facebook, you log into DraftKings.
Yeah.
You're back on.
Which is definitely interesting to see, because I think that's not the experience the states are hoping for. They put all these protocols into place, and whether the companies follow them, how they enforce it too is going to be, something very interesting. Because to enforce, if you're playing and you're in a state where it's legal, that takes the states a lot of money to enforce that. And they need to have the technology, and they need to be able to do it, and they need to invest in that kind of technology to track you. So it'll be interesting to see, how hard the states try to come down on that behavior and really keep these companies' toes to the fire.
But it's interesting why the take would be down, because we're not dealing with the scandal of the insider trading anymore. It's more, we still have this appetite for daily fantasy. Why would the take be down? Just simply advertising?
I think it's advertising. I do think that there's skepticism. And I also think that, industries and activities sometimes have a moment. And if you don't capitalize on it, that right exact time is kind of gone forever. I don't know how familiar you guys are, but internet poker in the, early 2000s, 2000, maybe 2010, was the biggest thing. Everyone was playing poker. Everyone, you couldn't turn on the TV without seeing the World Series of Poker. People were playing on these online gaming sites, which were actually, for most of that time period, illegal, but they were doing it anyway. And then in 2011, the feds decided, we're going to crack down, we're finally going to enforce our laws. They shut down all the sites, they made it legal, they made it virtually impossible for you to play in all the companies that were offering in the U.S. If they weren't arrested, they all fled the country, their founders left, and these sites were shut down, at least to U.S. residents. Fast forward, 2013, 2014, Nevada, New Jersey, Delaware legalized internet gaming or internet poker. No one plays internet poker. In New Jersey, internet gaming is doing decently, but it's really like online slot machines or online blackjack. No one plays poker anymore on these websites. And the reason why is, I think, because it lost its opportunity. Poker was huge. People love playing poker. But when it went away, they didn't really miss it. And I think that's somewhat probably what happened with fantasy. People were playing and they were playing addictively. But when it went away, in their states for the last 6, 7, 8 weeks of football season last year, they said, hey, I can enjoy Sunday without this. And I think that's also part of the problem. And I think the companies, their business challenge is to get those people back. Because their products are, like you mentioned, substantively the same. It may take a little longer to log on, and maybe the prize aren't as great, but you can still play if you really want to.
It's kind of tangential, but with like the rise of athlete-backed securities now, they're not exactly the same thing, but they kind of are. We're still putting your money and depending on how well an athlete will do.
Yes.
What's your take on that, I guess?
So you're saying like combine like how they relate to one another?
Or just, not that they're both gambling, but like you're still hedging your money on how well an athlete does.
Sure, yeah. And I guess that's an interesting question. I think that's why, looking at it from a really like minutiae level, like a legal approach, that's why most people argue fantasy sports isn't sports betting, is because you're, using the term very loosely, betting on how well a player performs, not the outcome of the game. And that's the same thing with athlete-backed security. It doesn't matter to you whether the Giants win or not, it's whether how Odell Beckham does, in either case. And that's a discussion we often had when we're talking with game regulators. They would say to us, but doesn't the outcome of the game matter here? And we would say, not really. It's how well the players you selected play. The other thing too is how well you do in athlete-backed security. You're ultimately looking at how well the player does, but it's really your ability to value that player versus what the market says they're worth. And the same thing in daily fantasy sports. When I'm playing, all that matters is whether I pick a player whose salary cap value is undervalued or overvalued. If I pick someone who's undervalued and I put them on my team, I'm going to do really well. If they're overvalued, they don't live up to their dollar value, I'm going to do bad. So I think in that way, they're very similar concepts. And I think you have to sort of take a step back and say, what am I really looking at here? head, you're sort of creating your fictional world. Like, you know, when you look at stocks, sometimes it's not always how well a company does, but how well they perform compared to what analysts say they're going to perform. And I think that's the same thing that you ultimately look for. And that's why, you know, so few people win on fantasy sports. A lot of these people who are doing really well are these former, you know, Wall Street traders who were able to take the same exact skills. They kind of like sports. Take those skills, throw an algorithm together like they probably did every day of their lives on different, you know, stock or bond market, and apply it to sports, and they made a lot of money doing it. So I'm not sure if that answers your question, but
it helps. I mean, I don't think there's an answer I'm looking for.
Yeah, it's like an interesting parallel, definitely, to think about. You follow the athlete-backed securities?
Somewhat. I did some reading last year when Cal Franco signed with, like, Fantex a little.
Yeah.
Just never coming, that's outrageous. But.
Yeah.
Is there more than Fantex? That's not what I've heard.
There are a few other smaller ones, but, like, the other thing is when they tried to request their IPO last year, and they took it away, like, I think a month after.
You don't hear a lot about it anymore. For a while there, it was something people talked about. It's definitely interesting topic.
Yeah, it's tough, especially when they're good NFL players who don't have guaranteed contracts. It's tough. It's a tough buy. But the injury risk. Any last questions? However, this has been great. Really fascinating. Let's thank Adam and all. I'll volunteer him to stay up here a few minutes.
Sure.
As we leave.
If you guys have questions, you know, feel free to email me, call me. I'm happy to talk if you guys need support.
Living, breathing example of the sports lawyer.
All right. We'll see you next week. Thanks.